Hi, my name is James. This video is about finishing a two-piece implant restoration. There's a lot of other videos on this site that goes through the scanning and also the design, the emergence design, all those things that are important to make it work. My goal is to get 95% of the design in the emergence and in the crown. Now, this video could also be the workflow for finishing a posterior restoration. This is actually a premolar implant restoration, but the techniques are the same, whether it's an implant or a single restoration that fits onto the abutment or restoration that fits onto a tooth. The workflow is the same. So our first video is about shaping in the restoration, the technique that I use. We do need to remember how we mill out our restorations. We have the M6L, the prime mill on chair side. I use the extra fine. That final burr on the right side is a little smaller, it's more of a cone. It will give you better anatomy on the occlusal surface. Having said that, I still like to use my lab burrs. It's the JK03 ceramic kit, the inverted cone to refine the occlusal anatomy, and also to refine that labial type of anatomy, the primary depressions, the perikymata where you need it, just to make it look really, really natural. As far as the abutment goes, we're just gonna polish the abutment subgingivally, whether it be zirconia or e.max in this case. Now, on a zirconia abutment, before we center, we wanna place with an inverted cone some mechanical retention. That way the final restoration will stay in place really, really well. On e.max, it's not as critical. You can place some undercuts with the inverted cone. It's not as critical there. It's easier to bond in an e.max restoration onto a e.max abutment. But having said that, let's go ahead with the shaping. It's a lot of fun. One more thing on shaping. When I'm using a five axis with fine mill, such as you see here, you can see all that occlusal anatomy is really refined, but that takes 41 minutes. The other side of that is if I'm using my prime mill on extra fine, that takes about 13 minutes for this restoration. I still refine the occlusal table, but there's not a lot to do. You have to weigh the time. The five axis, in this case, I'm using the PM7, is probably not a one appointment restoration. So I vacillate between the two based on whether I'm trying to deliver this in the same day or not. But let's go ahead and get started with the shaping. Just a quick note here. I love making these videos on YouTube and sharing it with the world. I love the feedback that everyone provides. I do have an online membership training site at kliminstitute.com. That's where I do a lot of videos for training, particularly in the CEREC genre from start to finish. I'm adding exocad to that as well. We also have live webinars. We do Q&A for those that are members. Just wanted to let you know that, because if you like what you see here on YouTube, there's a lot more of that on my teaching site there at jamesklim.com. Thanks for watching, and let's get back to the video. Separating diamond disc on the JK03 Meisinger lab kit. Separate that sprue. We clean up the holding bar with the pink diamond wheel. This is designed not to overheat the ceramic. Notice there is some dust that you see here, so protect yourself with a mask, and particularly if you can, get a vacuum system to collect the dust. You can also get tabletop vacuums now. I have that in my training center, and it really keeps things clean. Plus, it will protect you. This is a case I use for training at the kliminstitute.com for implant restoration design and finishing. You can see it just drops right in with the right parameters and design. We're gonna do some fine tuning. We map the adjacent teeth to pick up some of the nuances that we wanna duplicate with the refinement of this restoration. 95% of the shape and form is designed in the software, but for texturing and these subtle little nuances, it's nice to apply them with a diamond burr. This is a 150 diamond burr on the JK03 lab kit.
We're adding and emphasizing the primary depressions as they would relate to the adjacent teeth. This is fingerprinting the case. This is why I love CAD/CAM. This is why I like to control what I do in my clinical theater. I get joy doing this. That's why I'm still practicing after 40 years, because I look forward to customizing, being self-reliant with the process. The Thompson depression there on the mesial of the cusp. Notice that we scribe and scrub. So when you're shaping, you're scribing what you want to accomplish with your texturing. Then you scrub afterwards to neutralize and make it look natural. Perikymata effect on the cervical one half. Look at the adjacent teeth, build in that fingerprint, and then check and see how we've made progress. We want it to fit the DNA visual appeal of the mouth. Now we're going to go towards the occlusal table. I already mentioned with the five axes, we wouldn't have to do anything with refinement. I do this for me. This is the inverted cone on the JK lab kit. Here we're just amplifying the secondary and primary grooves. I do this for me. I just love the art and craft with what we accomplish with morphology chair side. For the sake of this video, a lot of different angles are demonstrated here. Usually chair side. Of course, I have a lab bench that's out of the operatory. I'll spend about 2 or 3 minutes on this, but I do love the craft of being creative. And here I'm just having fun. And one thing I've done is I have this book, actually several books. And from that, I get a visual template that has been imprinted in my brain that helps me with the shaping. Also with the fun of shaping. The 150 diamond is useful for neutralizing what we did with the inverted cone. Notice that as we view the extension of the secondary depressions, they kind of neutralize, they soften as they go toward the cusp tips. And at this time, I'm looking at the overall picture, just admiring it. And for the sake of learning here, we're going to add some secondary grooves to the marginal ridges. Envision what you see on the adjacent teeth. It's not a mirror image. This is a second premolar, but you want the flow, the vibe of the morphology to blend in. Now, I'm doing this for fun. This is what brings me joy. I think I've mentioned that a number of times, but as you build your skill set and you start noticing, the secret of aesthetic appeal on any restoration that we do is noticing what we see in the mouth. I've studied multiple mouths through the years. In fact, new patient exams, I'm looking at teeth that I find very attractive, and then I'll take a photograph of them. So I've built my mental portfolio and my templates from the natural mouth. The technique for groove refinement, as you see on a marginal ridge here, is light pressure. Let the diamond do the work with around 10,000 to 15,000 RPMs. And you just let the shape happen with a light pressure, and that will keep the ceramic very distinguished. And then once you're done scribing, as I've said before, we scrub it out. It's starting to take shape now. Let's try it back on the model. And yeah, it's looking a lot better. It's fitting that occlusal morphology vibe. And that's really what we're looking for here. Looking at all angles, this is the magic of refinement. I see another artistic need for lingual secondary groove refinement with the 150. You can create more of a depression, as you see on the first premolar. There's that depression. I'm just having fun accomplishing this. And as a noticer, you'll see more things. We're almost done here. The final finishing is accomplished with a green coarse silicone wheel. This is to polish the margins where that margin parameter bulk is for the mill. That's how we avoid chipping. This was milled with extra fine on the prime mill with the green coarse wheel. Carefully remove that extra thickness there at the margin with loops on. You can see it, and then we'll be able to test it on the abutment in just a moment. With the extra fine mill for e.max, you can see those margins are nice and tight. We're wanting to verify them and the fit, and take the green coarse wheel, holding that crown tightly onto the abutment, and polish that junction. And that will create a glass smooth transition from the abutment to the restoration. And these are the fits that I expect with margin quality from CAD/CAM. This is what we get with the CEREC system every day in our practice.
I love finishing. It's just a craft that I like to master. You can see that in this video that if we apply it just to the crown, that can be used anywhere in the mouth. Those are the techniques that we work through. So when I fire an e.max abutment or a one piece, I usually fire that before I place color on it, because it'll make the restoration a little more translucent if we fire it several times. That's the behavior of e.max. To fire these restorations, I place a patty on a firing tray and just lightly place it on that patty and then fire away. But it's really easy to do. Now, make sure you watch the next video. It's the completion of this series. We're gonna go ahead and place Mio 850, and this is a technique that I use on all my pre-crystallized Mio applications posteriorly. It's a workflow that works extremely well. Mio 850 has been a game changer for me in my clinical theater, and I can really nail it pretty well. If we need to add another layer on, we can do a second firing if we need to. But in general, one more thing on my e.max restorations on abutment, I most always use HT, mainly because that e.max is pretty thick if you include that and the abutment, and that can be a little brighter. So the thicker a ceramic, the brighter the ceramic is going to be. In a case like this, HT is my go-to. It has a softer look and it can look really natural. If you have any comments or questions, make sure you post them below and make sure you watch the next video. I'll talk to you then, real soon. Bye.